Hey, this is Lou Mangiello from WDW Radio, and you're listening to the Five-ish Fangirls Podcast. Let's do this.
The tangents this week continue all the way to episode 91 of the Five-ish Fangirls Podcast. Compromise where you can. Where you can't, don't. Even if everyone is telling you that something wrong is something right, even if the whole world is telling you to move, it is your duty to plant yourself like a tree, look them in the eye, and say, no, you move. Welcome, everyone, to this week's episode of the Five-ish Fangirls Podcast. So glad you can join us. Let's start off like we do every week by going to the virtual table and see who's joined us this week.
This is Brittany in Bovedale.
This is Chrissy in Salt Lake City.
This is Holly from Wisconsin.
This is Mitch in Kitchener, Ontario.
And this is Rachel in Indianapolis. Hello, everyone. We're all here. Yay!
Yay! It's been a while.
Some of us are frozen solid, even though it's mid-May. Yay! It's like...
I think there's some form of precipitation going down at every part of the country. We even got rain today.
So good. There's a polar bear that says, Happy Mayvember.
Yep. And that's about right.
One that I've seen with Chris Farley. Come on! Stop snowing!
It is so cold.
So we're in the vicinity of the stuff that no one wants. Yep. Precipitation.
Not even funny. So. Alright, well, we were off because we needed to let everybody go see Civil War. We've all seen it now, but we will get to that.
Well, I think part of that was my fault. I've had two college graduations this year, and that was last week. And
yeah.
Anyway, but yeah. We've all seen it, so we're good.
Yep, we're good now. So, but we'll get to that. So, first things first, just a little bit of news.
Suffice it to say, there will be spoilers for Civil War. So,
once we get past the news,
just be warned.
Stop if you haven't seen it yet.
although I think one bit of news might mention a little spoiler.
Maybe a little bit. Maybe not. So depends on what you read, actually, related to the news. Yes. What articles you decide to read. Minor spoiler warning, possibly. Everybody pull out your soapbox, get them ready. So unfortunately we're getting into finale season, but that also means finality for some shows. All the networks have gone around going, you're gone, you're gone, you're gone, you're gone, you're gone. And for like 95% of them are like, whatever. We didn't need 12 CSIs, you know, that sort of thing. But
yes.
Yeah. What?
Every once in a while, some of our favorites get axed, whether good or ill.
Forever. apparently ABC has decided to step on our hearts again by canceling.
ABC's turning into Fox, it seems.
Yeah, I don't know. So yes. The Castle cancel. I don't watch Castle, but I've seen the headlines with the people leaving. It's like, how's Castle going to continue with these people leaving? So, and it's been on for a while. So Castle, I think, was kind of on its way out, from what I understand.
Yeah, Tamala Jones. And I was like, how are you going to continue Castle without those two? I mean, maybe Tamala Jones I could see. Stanna, no. It's like, there would be mutiny if you tried. And we were talking about this before we started recording a little bit. It's like, I think a lot of these networks, they these showrunners are like, okay, you know, we've told our story, we're good. And the network's like, no, we still want more of your show because it gives us good ratings. And the showrunners are like, okay. What do we do now? What stories do we come up with? And I think a lot of these, like, first one that comes to my mind is 24, which I love 24. But after, I think, season 5, they were kind of like, okay, you know,
because season 5 just had this really high climax, really high stakes, just everything, like they threw the whole everything that they had at that season, and they're like, okay, what do we do for season 6? And from there on out, it just kind of slid down, and it wasn't quite as good, because I felt like they ran out of stuff to tell, but the network was like, no, we need more 3 more seasons out of you. And then they finally, you know, just canceled it, and people were like, oh, thank goodness, because, you know, it kind of felt like it had done its job. And I kind of think that's what's happened with Castle, is they've told a really good story, and, with the, you know, we love these characters and all this stuff, but they've started to run out of steam and run out of ideas, which is sad. You hate to see your favorite shows just run out like that, but sometimes these networks just run them into the ground. It's like they either... They're not on long enough, or they're on too long, and it's like we gotta figure out a balance here,
mm-hmm.
or something. I don't know, yeah. But that's my thought.
I think Supernatural was originally intended to be a 5 season arc. It's still going,
mm-hmm.
and I don't what? And they keep telling like pretty much the same story over and over, like Angel mm-hmm. Civil War. Of the apocalypse and the world ending,
and you're like, how many times can the world end?
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, mm-hmm. It's like now it's become the world-ending events are becoming. Oh, it's just another Tuesday. Like, oh, the world's ending again. Ah, oh, we'll let those guys deal with it. They always do.
I don't watch Supernatural anymore, but I've seen advertisements, and they're like, we've created a worse monster than the devil.
And you're like, going along with all your other worse monsters than the devil?
Lucifer is the worst at thing ever, and we created something worse.
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
The show is the something worse.
Yeah.
Stop. It's like 11 seasons. Just stop.
Yeah.
It's like by your estimation, the world ought become a crater by now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel
you. Anyway, so yeah, Castle, we kind of feel like, okay, it's time to go.
Yeah. The Muppets getting canceled, I'm not that surprised. I liked it, but I know a lot of people really didn't like it. A lot of people are like, this isn't the Muppets I grew up with. I'm like, no, that was a variety show where they had guests and they singed and danced. It was like the Carol Burnett show. This is the Muppets in the sitcom, so it's not even the same format.
Yeah. Well, I watched the first episode, and I just was so put off by... It didn't feel like... I know this sounds like the same kind of complaint, but trust me, it isn't. They didn't get the spirit of the Muppets right. I mean, yes, put the Muppets in a sitcom, you know, situation, but there was just something missing from it. It's like, this doesn't... It's some kind of intangible thing. I cannot, for the life of me, explain it. I just watched, I'm like, I'm watching Miss Piggy, I'm watching all these other characters, they don't feel right, there's something wrong here, and I cannot put my finger on what it is, and I can't explain it. I just, that was my problem with the show, was like, yeah. I don't feel like these are the same characters. It's not the show, it's the characters that I don't feel like, for some reason, I don't feel like they got it right, which makes me sad, because I really want to see, see the Muppets on TV again. Mm. But maybe this wasn't the best way to do it. I don't know.
Maybe.
There was just something wrong with it.
Yeah.
It's kind of like when you're typing and you see a word that you feel that you look at and you're like, okay, that's misspelled, but you keep checking and it's right grammatically and everything, but something about it just seems off. That's the best way I can explain it. That's how it was for me. I don't know how anybody else felt about it, but so I watched one episode and was like, no.
Yeah. So I'm not, like I said, I'm not terribly surprised, and I'm not overly upset about it either. So it's like, yeah, you know, it was something fun to watch for a half an hour, but then I had to walk away for half an hour before Agent Shield came on. So it's like, know, like, if it kills some time before Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. comes on, but not.
Yeah.
Maybe if it had been the half hour right before Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., that may have helped. I don't know. So.
What was between the two?
Fresh off the boat, I think.
Oh, okay.
Which that's still on.
Right.
So. Take that how you will. No. And. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Oh, I don't even want to talk about this one. I don't. I'm so mad and upset, I just want to punch someone or something or both.
I'm going to go out on a limb.
Yes.
And I'm going to say this one over.
It is. It really is. Oh. I read it. Agent Carter is what we're talking about, in case somebody's been living under a rock. Somebody posted an article, and it was before the announcement came out that Agent Carter got canceled. It was a couple weeks ago, and it was all about, you know, how Peggy Carter is just a great, you know, character, and she's so well-written, and she's a good, you know, role model for strong female characters, and, you know, blah, blah, blah. But then in the same article, the person was talking about how they were watching something... it was while Agent Carter was on this last season, but the ad was for, like, Ant-Man on DVD instead of Agent Carter, even though Ant-Man had came out, like, 9 months beforehand. So, it's like, it's simple things like that, because a lot of, I saw on, like, Facebook, people were like, well, I didn't realize it was on.
Well, that, they kind of shot themselves in the foot with making the DVD an exclusive for Amazon.
Yes.
Yeah, that was another thing. It's like, why is this not on Netflix? Why is the season DVD not available everywhere?
Mm-hmm.
You know, because there were people like, oh, I want to watch that, but I want to get caught up with season one first. And you're just like, crap.
Yeah.
What do I do?
It's almost like they were asking for Peggy to fail or something. The way they were doing this, like, at the very least, she should be on Netflix. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is on Netflix. Why isn't Agent Carter on Netflix?
Because like,
Chauncey's wanted to watch Agent Carter, but she's not on Netflix. She's not on anything.
I know, and I'm just like, what are you guys doing? I mean, this is a good show. People want to watch it. And I don't know if it's like, because some people are like, well, because I've seen people like try to get into like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and they start watching it and they're like, it's kind of a slow burn at first, and they're like,
oh yeah, the first season is,
and like I'm on the Salt Lake Comic Con closed group page, and they're all talking about, you know, everyone talks about different things. They're talking about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I'm like, no, it's good. Keep at it. Keep with it. Mm-hmm. And so I wonder if people kind of expected Agent Carter, to be the same way, like kind of a slow burn. I'm like, no. That one just jumps right in and gets right into it. And it's really good and all that kind of thing. And so it's like, this is like, maybe it's the name Carter, because it feels like they did the same thing with the movie John.
I know, I was saying the same thing with Chauncey. I said, Disney has it out for people with the last name Carter with their advertising department or something.
Something like that. I don't understand. This is, you know, Agent Carter's a Marvel property. It's, you know, they're raking in the big bucks with this. Netflix is doing awesome with their, you know, Daredevil, Jessica Jones, everything else they're doing over there, you know. Peggy, and this is Peggy, she's actually been in the movies, and she's been a mainstay of the different movies, and like...
And she's been in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and flashbacks.
Yeah, and like even more than, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. does tie into the MCU, don't get me wrong, but even more than Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Agent Carter ties into the movies and the TV. I think that show kind of felt like the bridge between all of it, and they just didn't market it right, and I'm like, what's to get? Like, what? Like, why is it so difficult for people to understand? Like, why would you do this or not do this right? I'm just like, maybe Peggy just needs to go to Netflix, I guess. I don't know.
Well, there's a petition out there.
Petition to bring her to Netflix.
The last I saw, it had like 21,000 signatures or something on it.
Yeah.
So.
And I don't doubt Netflix would pick it up, because they've already got the thing going on with Marvel, so
yeah,
why the heck not?
Yeah, and that would make it easier because
they'll bring the first two seasons.
Yeah.
On as like they'll get the first two seasons as well, so people can get caught up.
Yes.
Yeah, and that Netflix. What's funny is Netflix does so well with their marketing, which is funny because Netflix is an online only thing. But they get them on Facebook and Twitter, and they get the word out everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Like when Daredevil and Jessica Jones and Fuller House and all their other new stuff, like even stuff I don't watch on Netflix, and they say, "Oh, this is coming to Netflix. You gotta see this." Blah blah blah. Like every month, there's some like every. Every website has an article. Here's what's coming to Netflix. Here's what's leaving. And here's the list. And so, like, Netflix knows how to market. So I think, you know, if they want to pick up Agent Carter, I think that would be a great idea.
Mm-hmm.
And ABC just basically shot themselves in the foot with that. And I'm putting the blame on them.
Yeah. Because there's nothing wrong with the show.
We can always recast Conviction. I know Haley was supposed to star in that, but hey, if the Netflix deal comes along...
Yeah, I would say doing a Netflix, you know, putting it on Netflix would still work with Haley doing this new show.
Mm-hmm.
So because film it all at once and then it goes up on Netflix. So
yeah. Oh, and in that same vein, I know I'm like taking a lot of stuff or a lot of time here. I've seen more ads for Conviction with Haley Atwell, you know, emblazoned on the trailer, and I'm like, you didn't do this when she was in Agent Carter. Like, what the heck is wrong with you?
Mm-hmm.
So I've seen so many ads for Conviction on Facebook and on Hulu and all these things. I'm like, and I have the no commercials plan with Hulu, and I'm like, geez, like, what is your problem? It's like you couldn't do this when she was on the Marvel show, the Agent Carter. Why couldn't you do this?
Yeah.
So apparently they want Conviction to do well.
It probably won't.
It's probably more in ABC's wheelhouse, like, you know, the Scandal, How to Get Away with Murder, Revenge, soap opera,
yeah, whatever else. You want to talk about shows that I can't believe are still on the air? Hello, Grey's Anatomy.
Yeah.
It really. Jeez,
that kind of. I don't know what you call it.
It's like ABC, it seems like they put so much time and money and energy into that Thursday night lineup with the all the Shonda Rhimes programs.
Oh, yeah, but her stuff.
Yes, you know, the Scandal, the How to Get Away with Murder, the Grey's Anatomy. It's like, what about us geeks? Hello, over here. People who are actually
watching your shows.
Yeah, hello, over here. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Agent Carter, the non-drama soap opera-y stuff. Hello?
The stuff that people aren't worried about. Ooh, who's sleeping with who now? Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, they're glorified soap operas. That's all it is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Pretty much. But there's a very large audience for that. We're outnumbered, unfortunately.
Yeah. I guess so. I'll be the first to admit I'm biased against soap operas. At all. I don't care if it's the daytime soap opera or the prime time, whatever that is.
Yeah,
ABC is known for it. I'm like, the only reason I still watch you is because you have Once Upon a Time,
mm-hmm.
and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Mm-hmm.
But slowly, and this is weird. Speaking, and this will be our next bit of news, I guess.
Yeah.
It's slowly my allegiance is turned over to the CW, which I never thought that would happen.
Yeah.
Right? I never, like, God.
Back in the day, CW is where reruns went to die.
Yeah, or you know, they had the teen drama.
Teen soap operas.
Yeah,
teen soap operas. I couldn't stand those, but now it's like all DC comic stuff on TV, you know, the Arrowverse, and I'm like, yay, I love this. Which, you know, the other big news is that Supergirl is moving from CBS to the CW, which is where she probably should have been from the start.
Probably.
But I'm not complaining.
Yeah, considering I can't get CBS on my TV, yeah.
Yes, that's my other complaint is, like, CBS, they don't play ball with Hulu or Netflix or any of these other things. They have their own little thing, and it's like, why?
Yeah.
But whatever. Supergirl's going to CW instead of CBS, which I'm like, good.
Yeah. Considering it looked like Supergirl potentially could get canceled too, so she's found a new lease on life.
Yeah. And you know, they take care of that, of those shows over on CW. They, like, Flash, Arrow, Legends of Tomorrow, and now Supergirl. So, like, those are kind of their big, well, and I guess Supernatural, too. But, that like we said, they're kind of in a ballpark all their own. But,
so
that's some good news, I guess.
Yeah, well, and of course, the other networks, but we don't watch those.
Yeah,
like NBC, Fox, what?
Although
with all your CSIs and Law and Orders and
yeah,
whatever.
The John Stamos was in the Grandfathered, and I follow him on Facebook because yay, John Stamos. And that was like one I wanted to get into. I just didn't have time, and they said it was canceled. I'm like, oh, it's on Fox, so you know.
Yeah.
But I kind of like maybe when the season gets put on Netflix or something, or when the DVDs become available at the library, I'll get them and watch them.
Yeah.
Because my grandma liked that. My grandma liked Grandfathered. I wanted to watch it, but I just didn't have time. But my grandma liked it, and we tend to have similar tastes, so maybe.
And it's Uncle Jesse. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
Except we know he'll be he'll be on Fuller House, so.
Yes, that's true. Which, they actually did start filming season 2 this week, I believe. Mm-hmm. I saw posts about it, so yay! Yep. More Fuller House.
Yeah. So we have that. Yay! Anyway. I'll put my soapbox away for now.
For now, yes. So, anyway, on to some positive news. Yeah. Big Finish continues to find ways to separate me from my money. Although this actually doesn't cost any money.
Yeah.
They have an app. So if you ever bemoaned the fact that you bought Big Finish audios on download and you had to hook your iPod or iPhone or whatever MP3 player to your computer to download the audios into your player or whatever. Well, now you can get them. You still have to buy them from Big Finish, the website, bigfinish.com. But once you bought them and you log into the app with your phone, they're all on your app, and you can download them and listen to them there. And I've already done that, and I've just to kind of test it out. The app itself is free, and it's kind of cool.
The app has been out for a while. It's just they've made it better now.
Yes. I and like they got I can't remember the guy's name.
It's fancier.
Fantastic.
Yes, and I was like, just kind of. I didn't even know they had an app, so I just started playing around with it and downloading some of the audios I have. I'm like, this is so slick. I like it. And so now I'm like, I mean, you can't buy the stuff directly.
That's probably a good thing, actually, for me.
Yeah.
They'd have to make this deal with Apple, and like you'd have end up having to pay more for Big Finish because Comixology, that you could buy through the app, but now they don't, so you don't have to pay as much.
Yeah. Which I appreciate because Big Finish gets enough of my money as it is, although with that deal, also someone would be going to Apple, but whatever. You can filter by the ranges, which is nice, especially if you have a whole bunch. You can, you know, sort by the title, the date that you bought it, or the release date. And I assume they're going to be doing a lot more with it as time goes on. But yeah, it's just so cool. I love it.
Probably. Yeah,
and you can
kind
of keep track of everything you bought.
In 1963, I have right now on my iPod. I have the three ones that they released for the 50th, like the 1963 series.
Mm.
Oh yeah.
Then the iDabros stuff.
Yep.
Which I keep meaning to listen to, but I.
So it's pretty darn awesome. I love it. So yay, Big Finish. And then also, good news that they will, they have the license is been extended to 2025, the Doctor Who license for Big Finish. And they put out a little short video of Nicholas Briggs announcing this and just kind of talking about Big Finish. And he's like, you know, thanking everybody who's been there since 1999. And I got thinking, I'm like, holy cow, 1999 was 17 years ago. By the I can't believe this. And it's like,
that's a lot of Big Finish audios.
Yeah. Well, I'm just kind of thinking about in general of how much, like,
yeah.
Like, I posted on Facebook that someone had this little post that said, I love reading old sci-fi because they talk about how advanced we're going to be in the year 20, you know, the futuristic space year of 2003. And we're like, oh, old sci-fi, you had such high hopes for us.
Yeah. It's like, here it is.
But it's still
2016. We all listen to Doctor Who Big Finish audios on our phones.
Yes. That is quite a technological feat. Don't get us wrong.
Well, yeah, that's true.
Like, we're not colonizing the moon yet.
No.
Mm-hmm. No.
Nope,
but
not yet.
Anyway, but yay, Big Finish! They can keep making Doctor Who and Torchwood and
my wallet else. Cries. My wallet cries. It's like 2025, so it's like okay, nine. It's like, yay, 9 more years of Doctor Who Big Finish. And it's like, oh, 9 more years of paying for Doctor Who Big Finish.
Which I am happy to do. I am happy to do. They put out a quality product. So it's like, if you give me something of value, I will gladly fork over my money.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I'm happy and my wallet cries at the same time.
Yeah.
Invest in bigger hard drives.
Yeah.
Yep.
That too. Thank goodness for the cloud.
That too. And now with the app, you can access your cloud. So, yeah, exactly. Hooray!
Mm-hmm. Yay. All right. Oh. All righty. Last bit of news. According to Entertainment Weekly, we now have our young Han Solo for the yet to be properly titled Han Solo origin movie that's going to be coming out in 2018. And I have no idea how to pronounce this kid's last name. I'm so sorry.
Alden Ehrenreich?
Ehrenreich?
Yeah, it's as good as... I don't know who this kid is properly, but all I can say is when this announcement came out, I hit my knees and thanked everything in the universe that it was not Miles Teller or Ansel Elgort.
Yeah.
I was just like, oh, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Because when I saw those names floated as possibilities for being cast as Han Solo, I was just like, no.
Well, I think there was a general outcry against all of them, so they scrapped that entire list and went with someone new.
Yes. Yeah. And that was the wise decision because you don't... So were some people saying, oh, you know, do Chris Pratt or something or somebody like that, even though this character, you know, Han Solo is going to be younger. But even then I was like, you want somebody who isn't well known because if you get someone that everybody already knows, you're going to be seeing them as, you know, say you cast Chris Pratt, like you're going to be seeing him as Chris Pratt and not as Han Solo or, you know, whoever it is they cast. So I'm glad that it's somebody that I don't recognize very well because... Yeah. I don't want to see someone I know. I want to see Han Solo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
And they've done a good job so far. I mean, with, you know, with The Force Awakens of, you know, mm-hmm. getting new, young, fresh faces that may have been in something, but it probably wasn't very mainstream, so therefore they weren't, like, people going, well, they're just, like you said, that's Chris Pratt doing this. So, mm-hmm. you know, before, you know, you take someone like Chris Pratt, who was fairly popular on Parks and Recreation, but there was a lot of cast on Parks and Rec who were famous mm-hmm. in their own right. So when he became Peter Quill for Guardians of the Galaxy, you know, it's like, ooh, you know,
Yeah, and everybody's just
like, oh, where'd this guy come from? He's amazing, you know, and then he goes back and does Parks and Rec and is awesome, mm-hmm. is Andy. And now with the other Star Wars, you know, The Force Awakens, you know, someone like Daisy Ridley and John Boyega, and, you know, it's like, I don't know you, I've never seen you in anything before, but I like you in this role. Yep. Good job.
Mm-hmm. So. Yep. And even, like, even now when I see Harrison Ford in some other movie, I see him as Han Solo. I don't care, you know, that he's a lot older or he's playing something else. Like, I saw him in, what was that movie? Age of Adeline?
Mm.
And I was like, it's Han Solo! And I still, you know, and he's a lot older and he's playing an older man and he's playing, you know, like he's playing it older. And I'm like, no, you're Han Solo. I don't care.
Yeah.
And that's what I want this new young version of Han Solo to be is I this might not be fair to this, to Alden, hard to pronounce that last name.
Yeah.
But I want to see you as Han Solo for the rest of your life. So, you know, deal with it.
Yeah. Well. Oh, but that is currently scheduled for May 25th, 2018, so it'll be a Memorial Day weekend release.
Yay.
So, if everything goes to plan, subject to change, as we've already seen happen with episode 8, so
yep.
It's already been moved.
Well, and that's kind of the danger of them putting all these dates out so far in advance is inevitably they will change. I mean, we've already seen this with Marvel having to move stuff around.
Yeah.
But that's okay. Yeah. That's part of how this goes.
Very much so. So, but that is it for news. One little piece of housekeeping, just in case you have not liked us on Facebook and therefore missed the announcement. We are now also on Google Play.
Woo!
So for those of you folks that if you use Google products, I guess.
Android. I think
Android.
It would be, yeah.
Yeah. Android
and I think
/ Google or whatever else you use Google Play devices on. So
I'm trying to remember. I can't remember if it's... Well, I don't know. Nook might be on its way out. But I think it's either Nook or Kindle that they have a thing with Android for apps. And I'm pretty sure it's Nook, maybe. Mm-hmm. I'd have to double check on that. But anyway, one of those, you can get Android.
Yeah.
That has the Google Shop.
Yes. Because I guess Google's been working on their own podcast, like iTunes thing for a while. And we're asking for the info for podcasts. Ooh, this probably had to have been good 6 months ago, I think, is when I submitted our RSS feed into it. So, and then they've been working on it since. And then their podcast store, whatever you want to call it, went live, I think, last month. But it was slowly rolling out on the feeds actually being able to work. So we had the link, but they said it would take a while for all the links to become valid and functional, and ours finally started working in the last week or so. So
that's technology for you.
Yes, it is.
Mm-hmm. It's all good, though.
Yep, it's all good. So, alrighty. Well, let's move on here. Spoiler alert!
Spoiler alert!
Sound the alarms! I've still got that sound effect that I used for Star Wars. I'll bust it out again.
The sound die! One trailer.
Yeah. Oh my! Captain America: Civil War. Okay. We're going to make this easy starting out here. So, the table here, going into the movie, before you saw it, but going into the movie, were you Team Stark or Team Cap? Nobody wants to confess which side you were on.
I'm like, which side was... Well, going on what I knew of the comic, because I had read the Civil War comic, and I know the story would be different. I'm going to say I was Team Cap. Yeah. But in reality, I was Team Peggy.
I was Team Stark going into it. Unashamedly so. Chauncey was Team Cap, which made going to the movies with him quite interesting.
I'm like, it's like, does this really cause, you know, strife between, you know, family members and friends?
It might, I don't know.
I'm sure somewhere along the line it did.
I saw a lot on Facebook, like, the husband would be like, one team, wife would be the other, so.
Well, you know, the name of the movie was aptly chosen.
Yeah. So. I think on my Facebook feed, a majority of my friends were Team Cap. It seemed to sway more in Cap's favor.
I had Stark, and then it turned to Team Cap. It was kind of, you know, an even mix. And for me, I was trying to stay neutral and be both. I think I was probably Team Stark to begin with, then Team Cap, and then it's just like, okay.
Yeah. I was divided. I was torn there for a while. It's like, it's like I kind of see Steve's side, but I really love Tony Stark. He's like one of my favorites. And then it's like, oh, no, no. Well, and then Chris Evans was like, yeah, I'm Team Stark. I was like, well, okay. I'm going Team Stark. That and Chris Evans is New England Patriots fan, so I couldn't side with him.
Yeah.
If my life depended upon it.
Yeah, well, and, okay, so you know, like, when I saw the movie,
yeah,
when I finally did see the movie, one thing I appreciated about it was that it has, the whole MCU has been building up to Tony, you know, having, you know, I can see why he did what he did, or, you know, how he did, or mm-hmm. how he sided, because, you know, that, and I don't fault him for it, but I don't fault Steve either for his thing, because Steve's like, you know, we're doing the best we can with what we have, and if you hamstring us with these Sokovia Accords, we're not going to be able to help. And, you know, what happens when the government says, okay, now we're going to use the Avengers to be our personal weapon, and they have to because of this thing that you signed? And he's like, he's already seen that, like with Bucky. Is he was, you know, taken over by Hydra, and Hydra was part of, you know, all these shady government things and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But Tony, and Tony, he was like, you know, clear back in Iron Man 1 and 2, that he was all, you know, I'm going to take control, I'm going to be in charge, and I'm going to make things great. And then he just lost control all over the place, and, you know, he's... Like every bad thing that's kind of happened is, I don't want to say every bad thing that's happened, but a lot of it is Tony Stark's fault.
Well, Ultron was definitely Tony's fault.
Ultron was definitely Tony's fault.
The first New York
was not, because
that was all in Loki.
I wanted them to say, well, the suits when General Ross was in there, you know, blaming them for the Battle of New York, it's like a bunch of suits in the shadowy meeting place, they were gonna nuke the city. So I'm like, well, you can't blame us for that.
Yeah.
I saw a post that was like lines that were missing from Ultron in no particular order, and one of them was, you were gonna nuke New York, and you're upset we knocked over a few buildings.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, okay, we basically saved New York from you guys.
Yeah.
Not necessarily Loki.
Yeah. I was like, it's like when Ross was, you know, like, the Battle of New York, I'm like, that was a homicidal maniac demigod from another realm.
Yeah, it's like, okay,
and a World Security Council whose head of it is Hydra, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and then he's like, the destruction in Washington, D.C. is like, Hydra?
Hydra.
It's like Sokovia, yeah, that was kind of on them, or that was on Tony, because that was Ultron.
That was on Tony, which, again, goes back to Tony saying, like, he has to be in control. And if he's not in control, well, you know, somebody like the UN or whoever, the government agency, has to be in control.
Yeah.
And Steve is all like he's seen what happens when governments get way out of control and with way too much power and things. And, you know, he's seen what they did to Bucky, and they've, and, you know, with these, you know, if someone else is controlling the people with the powers, if the people with the powers don't have, you know, the ability to do what they feel is right, then, you know, that leads to chaos and anarchy, well, not anarchy, but, like, I want to say totalitarianism, but I'm not even sure that's quite right either. I mean, there are some really deep conversations you can have about things with this movie, and maybe it's just...
I think you're completely right, and that's one of the things that when, you know, as Chauncey and I were talking about it after the fact, is, you know, this whole thing has been marketed, you know, Team Cap versus Team Stark, and whose side are you on, and really, the movie ended almost at a stalemate, and there's so much gray area that really you can't definitively say that one side was right and the other side was wrong.
Yeah. And that's where this movie works. I mean, we've spent all this time, like you said, Rachel, you like Tony Stark. He's one of your favorite characters. So you wanted to be Team Stark. And it's like, and like, you like these characters, like we, and even the other Avengers on both sides, like we love Black Widow. We love Scarlet Witch. We love Hawkeye. We love Ant-Man. We love, you know, Falcon and War Machine, and like, and we were introduced to Black Panther in this movie, which I cannot wait for his solo movie.
Oh yes! Oh my God, he was so good.
I'm like, I want that movie so bad. I mean, before I was like, oh yeah, it's another one of the movies in the lineup, and I'm like, dude, I want to see Wakanda. I want to see.
Is so amazing.
Yes, I was like, I didn't know what to think of the story. He was just kind of like there.
The history of Black Panther in the comics. It's really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I didn't know any of that going into this. Like, oh yeah, he's a new character. Yes, I think I was looking forward to, you know, I think I was looking more forward to Spider-Man, but I think Black Panther's the one that really took me by surprise, and I was like, oh wow, you're really cool.
Yeah.
I didn't know anything about him.
I mean, the few bits we saw of him in the trailer, like, you know, with the bullets raining down on him, and he's just standing there like, what? And I'm like, okay, this is not a guy I want to mess around with.
Well, and just when Hawkeye introduces himself, I don't think we've been introduced yet. I'm Clint. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, he's like, I'm going to kill you if you get in my way.
I don't care.
Yeah. And the people he keeps with him, I don't know if you guys have seen, like, the one scene when they release him and Natasha's standing there and his, like, assist, move or you will be moved. And people are like, yes. No!
Who are you? What's your name?
Are you going to be in the Black Panther movie? Because you're awesome.
The way Marvel is, if they hadn't had any further plans for her,
they do now.
They have plans now.
Yeah, they do now.
Talking about her.
Yeah.
You know, whether she has a bigger role in Black Panther or something like that, I don't know. Yeah. But oh gosh, yeah, that whole thing was.
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, it was. So.
And what's interesting about this is, like, okay, this is a Captain America movie. Captain America is the main guy. You know, Bucky is his friend, and that's part of the plot. Tony Stark is doing his thing. But they've given enough time to all these side characters. And I think it was Andre from Black Nerd Comedy,
because
he was talking about this. His spoiler review of this movie is, like, they managed to get everybody a good enough time to shine. It wasn't just they were there for a brief cameo and then they were gone. So like, and I'll use Black Panther as an example. Like, you meet him at the Sokovia Accord meeting, you meet his father, you get that connection to these characters, Then his father dies. You see him mourn over his father. You see him want to take vengeance on Bucky because they think that Bucky's the one that's
Which is pulled straight from the comics. Bucky being framed for killing the King of Wakanda.
Yeah. And then, you know, and is it T'Challa? Is that how they say it?
Mm-hmm.
The guy's name, the Black Panther's name.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, he says, like, you know, we're a civilization of warriors. We have, you know, we have this great tradition. And I am king now, so I have this responsibility. So yeah, I'm gonna go after this guy. And then he finds out it really wasn't Bucky. And then he's like, then he backs off. It's like, and you see that, you know, that honorable side of him. He's like, okay, I will not take revenge on someone who did not commit this crime. And even at the end when he's watching, you know, Tony fight Steve and Bucky over, you know, we'll get to that. And he sees that and he's like, you know, this, you know, vengeance isn't the answer, you know, because this is tearing these people apart who were good friends. You know, I will not let, my honor will not let me do this, mm-hmm. you know, just kill Simo, the guy who was actually responsible for it. So you see, like, that whole character arc growth in a character that this isn't even really his movie.
I know.
He's in it. It's just like, wow. Yeah, like, well, good job.
There was a five-star article that was like, 26 Captain America Civil War tweets that'll make you laugh and then cry. And one of them is on the movie's true title. Someone is like, him, did you like the movie? And then the person responding, yes, I liked Black Panther Civil War. He's like, him, wait, what? I said what I said.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And it's like, and you know, Scarlet Witch even got some of that too, where she was, you know, cooped up in Stark Tower because she felt guilty for, you know, I guess she does shoulder some of the blame, but not entirely, because at the beginning she couldn't hold the explosion and it blew up part of the building, and then by the end she's like, no, I'm not gonna blame myself for this forever because I still have a choice.
Like the guys covered on Traveling the Vortex, if she hadn't, a lot more people would have died on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, like she, and that's what Steve was trying to tell Ross was, and Tony and all them was like, it's like, you know, what would happen if we weren't there? Like, what, you know, because Crossbones was after that virus, and if it would have gotten out, a lot more people would have died.
Yeah,
and I mean, and that's just, you know, when you're dealing with villains and with bad psychos. People, and evil psychos.
Yeah,
it's gonna happen inevitably, but the difference is the good guys feel bad about it. The good guys, you know, they do their best, and they grieve when they make mistakes make mistakes that mean people die. But you know, they're the ones that are trying to stand up to the bad guys who just wouldn't care if the whole city blew up.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, Scott, Shadow, as soon as you saw her take that deep breath, and then you saw it go, she's like, the look on her face is like, oh,
yeah.
You know, so she felt it right away. She knew she was doing good, but then when that happened, it's like, oh, you really felt for her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much so. And that's one of the things, that's Steve's point. They're like, if we weren't there, more people would get hurt. And like, that's one of those points and lines where it's like, okay, yeah, I can kind of see Steve's points. And then, you know, with Tony, you know, I don't necessarily agree that the Avengers need to have someone necessarily watching over them and being in charge, but I think it's probably a good idea to have, because I know we saw this in Age of Ultron with when they did go to Wakanda, when, you know, Bruce hulked out and Tony could not get him under control even with the Hulkbuster suit, you know, go to sleep.
Yeah.
You know, that Tony has, you know, this Stark Foundation to help pay for, like, repairs, but who is going and taking care of the families where people maybe get killed, who are getting caught in the crossfire? Who's helping to pay for the medical care for the people who get injured? Are they offering any sort of, like, you know, emotional, psychological support for the people who are going to be traumatized after this? That, you know, maybe there should be an organization that goes in after the fact and tries to help with the emotional and physical, and not, I don't mean building wise, but person wise.
Well,
physical,
because
that's something
Shield,
that,
and then,
yeah.
And then Hydra screwed that up.
Right. And Shield is having to work in the shadows. We know that Shield is still there, but they have their hands full with what's going on with them, you know. And even if they didn't, they're supposed to be working in the shadows, you know, and acting like they don't exist because, you know, they've got the full support of the President of the United States, but he would probably denounce them if
he can't acknowledge it.
He can't acknowledge it.
Like I said, Hydra screwed all that up.
Yes, yes. And they still are. And that's the thing, you know, in Age of Ultron, you know, they took down that base and got Loki's scepter, and they're all like, yep, you know, that was the last Hydra base. Hydra's done. And, you know, we're watching Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. going, no, Hydra's not done.
Wait, so not done. Yeah.
And we've, you know, even now in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., spoilers, you know, technically Hydra has been taken down, and not really by S.H.I.E.L.D. as far as the public is concerned. It was the army and Talbot that have taken down all those remaining Hydra strongholds. But we saw with Zemo when he was trying to get that. Yeah, there's still Hydra, even if they're not actually Hydra, maybe Hydra supporters or sympathizers out there. Because that guy that Zemo was torturing to try and get information out of him by hanging him upside down in the sink.
Oh, gosh. You know?
So, Hydra's never really going to go away, I don't think.
That is true. And I think, I don't know. I mean, I think they're doing a fine job of dealing with that, with the fallout from that, too. But it's like,
yeah.
How do you fix this?
I don't know. If we figure it out, somebody tell
Phil. It's kind of like, you know, why they don't ever make Rumpelstiltskin fully a bad guy. It's like they always need to have a bad guy to be the antagonist. So they can't ever, same thing here, they can't ever get rid of Hydra, because they're a good villain for them to use all the time.
Yeah. But, you know, they can't, I mean, we know what's coming. That's the thing, is they can't keep playing the Hydra card.
Yeah.
You know, I heard a review, it was just a short review, but it was a review of Civil War on NPR, and it was their entertainment review guy. And, you know, in general, he was quite positive about it, but he was all like, you know, they're bringing in even more heroes, and, you know, they've fought against aliens from, you know, coming from the sky, and now they're fighting each other, and with all these new heroes coming into the fold, you know, who's, and I don't know if he was just being, you know, if it was a rhetorical thing, or if he was being facetious, or if he just is truly not in touch with what's going on as far as the plans for the MCU. He's like, who's going to be next? You know, who can they fight next? I'm like, Thanos? Hello? Like, the ultimate guy from outer space is coming. Like, he's Infinity Stones. You know, we get these, you know, we had that scene with Vision talking to Wanda, you know, about the gem that's in his head. He's like, it's brought me life, but I want to understand it.
Yeah,
because that's going to be
better how to control it.
Yeah, but it's going to become important when Thanos comes to try to retrieve it from his forehead.
Yes,
right.
Which is good that they referred to that, because, you know, we're like, okay, yeah, we haven't forgotten about all these other things that are going on. So I appreciated that they gave a nod to that, even though that wasn't the main focus of this movie.
Right. Yeah.
So it's like, yeah, the
I can't remember which stone he has. Energy stone?
No, he's got the mind stone. It's the mind stone. Yeah.
Yeah. I keep losing track of all
I know. Well, we haven't seen them all yet either, so.
Yeah, that is true.
We've only seen three out of the five.
The galaxy. Was that the energy stone or?
Maybe that one of them was the ether from
the one in Guardians of the Galaxy, the one that's inside Vision, and then the Tesseract. So we've seen four out of the six.
Six, yeah,
because there's six total. As the collector said, one down, five to go. So
and then Thanos is like. Well, if anybody's gonna do it, you gotta do it yourself.
Yeah.
Which he's still tying his shoes.
Yeah, he's getting dressed. He's getting ready. He's getting ready, but you know he'll be here in what 3 years, so
something like that.
you know, interdimensional travel. It's not as fast as you think. That's why Loki would have to converse with. Thanos is a little dude via, his mind, because he could, take too long to actually physically go there.
So, yes.
That's my excuse, and I'm sticking with this.
There's Skype connections a little.
Exactly.
Okay.
Anyway.
So, what else Civil War can we talk about? I guess Spider-Man, we kind of touched on it. What do we all think of?
God, I love him. I've been saying this even going into it, because people are like, oh my God, they're doing, they're casting another Spider-Man. We're going to get a Spider-Man. Like, you know what? They're on their third Bruce Banner. They got it right on the third try. They're on their third Spider-Man. They got it right on the third try.
Yes. And this was actually Marvel Studios doing the Spider-Man. So
that too, but there. Still, yeah. It's like, sometimes with these characters, third time is the charm when it comes to the casting.
fanboy moments.
Oh.
Just like Coulson.
Yeah. Him and Ant-Man together are brilliant for comic relief.
Did anyone else go old when he first vampire the really old movie?
Yes.
I was like,
what do you like? Why do you have to say it's this? I saw this really old movie. It's like everybody knows what Star Wars is. Come on.
Well, Empire was what?
83. 82.
Yeah.
No, Empire was 80. Return of the Jedi was 83.
Return
of the Jedi was 83.
Yeah, oh. So 36 years. Okay. So, yeah, that's kind of old.
That's what I said.
No matter how old you are. I mean, 30 plus years, that's
okay.
A decent amount of time. So, but yeah, I thought that was brilliant. And I'm glad I never clicked on, and I remember seeing it on like Facebook, like with the Funko thing with Ant-Man, apparently the there's a giant man. It's a Funko of Ant-Man, but it's labeled Giant Man. And I remember seeing it on Facebook saying, "Does this Funko Pop, reveal a spoiler?" And I didn't click on it. I'm glad I didn't, because I was like, "I'm not clicking on anything." But after the fact, they're like, people knew that, because the Giant Man thing took me completely by surprise.
Oh yeah,
Scott was all like, "Well, I have this thing. If I tear myself in half, if I tear myself in half, don't come back for it." I'm like, "What is he talking about?" And then he was like, King Kong in the airport. I'm like, oh my God.
And then Tony's all, if anyone on our side has any special abilities, I haven't told us yet.
Yes.
Yeah.
Boy, that would be the
time. Yeah. I love Paul Rudd as Scott Lang. It is perfect as casting. And I have been loving it, with all the press and everything. And Paul Rudd is like, there's a scene in the movie when we see Scott for the first time, and after Clint goes to pick him up, and he's shaking Steve's hand. He's like, I'm shaking your hand for too long. I'm like, and Paul Rudd is all like, yeah, that really wasn't acting. That was really just me going, oh my God, I can't believe I'm here. Like, this is my life.
He is such a joy.
He is. I love him. So I was like, yeah, I was totally feeling Paul Rudd when he was talking badly. He's like, I'm not there on set, and there's like Robert Downey Jr. with the Iron Man suit, and there's, you know, Chris Evans with his muscles and everything. And Paul Rudd's like, like internally screaming, or like, yeah, that would be me if I had been in your shoes. I totally feel for you, Paul Rudd.
Welcome. Wasn't he the one that was like, he went to the prop master while Chris Evans was on break and like, can I hold the Captain America shield?
I've held the Captain America shield. It's pretty awesome. It's a pretty cool prop. It's very heavy. It is very cool.
You need a workout just to be able to lift that sucker.
Yeah, you kind of do. Yeah. I had, like, the guy standing right next to me, like, prepared if I started to drop it to dive in and catch it.
But you can't let that hit the floor.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like the flag.
Yeah, no. But, yeah, as serious as this movie is, it does have some funny bits. It's not nearly as many funny bits as what we're used to. But it does have the funny bits, and it comes from the people that you would expect, like the Scott Lang, Spider-Man. He's pretty funny. He's hilarious.
And, that one bit where Falcon uses Red Wing to take out Spider-Man, and like, couldn't have done that earlier.
Yeah.
I hate you.
No, well, even just the first introduction of Red Wing when he's using him in the first bit, and he's like, I named him Red Wing. Isn't he cute? And they're like, I'm not calling it Red Wing. I was like, yes, he's cute. I want a Funko Pop of him.
What's a nice nod to the comics? Because in the comics, Falcon has an actual Falcon named Red Wing. It's an actual bird.
After that bit, Jared leaned over and said, "That's actually he has an actual Falcon from the comics." I'm like, "Yeah, I kind of guessed that." Yeah.
Like, we have to make this more modern, so he gets a drone instead. So, which that in itself is cool.
It works.
Yeah. I'm glad that they're still able to inject some humor in there, just because so much of it is so serious.
In a way, I mean, don't get me wrong. I like what Joss Whedon did with the Avengers, but sometimes the jokey bits got kind of a little too much. And I'm kind of glad that there's still humor here, but I kind of like that they went the direction they did with it, and it feels more appropriate in this movie what they did. So I'm like, okay, yeah, I like what they did with the humor here.
Yeah.
I think some
of that is a testament to the writers of the script, and off the top of my head, I don't know who all wrote the script, and then also the direction of the Russo brothers, because the Russo brothers directed Winter Soldier.
Yes.
And they're also going to be directing Infinity War.
Mm-hmm.
So, but which, you know, considering a lot of people consider Winter Soldier one of the best Marvel movies in the entire MCU, and I would agree. I mean, it's pretty darn good as far as the Marvel movies are go, and this is really good. I mean, so I think
honest trailers even said like, this is a pretty good movie, and they, you know, they had to get their comedy, they had to nitpick, and they even admitted, we're nitpicking.
Yeah.
This movie was really awesome.
It's a really good movie, so, you know, as these movies, as we move closer to Infinity War, and it's getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and the stakes are getting higher, and, you know, more people are getting involved, and more people potentially get hurt in the process, that I think that Infinity War is in really good hands as far as directing goes with the Russo brothers. And apparently, I don't remember which one it is, but one of the Russo brothers is the dead body in the bathtub.
Oh.
Yes. That is one of the directors.
Well, hey, you know, if you're directing a Marvel movie, and you can put yourself in a cameo, why wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Even if it is.
Well, at least you don't have to worry about remembering any lines.
You just have to lay there. You're fine.
You just have to lay there and act dead.
It's kind of like the way people, like, act, you know, unknown actors get jobs as the corpses in CSI.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Whatever it takes.
So. Yes.
Ooh,
so anyway, so we've talked about all the funny bits.
Yeah.
Should we get into the really, like, heartbreaking, heart-wrenching? Well, there were a number of them.
Well, I do want to mention one other thing that helped me, that did bring some levity to it. And it wasn't, I don't think, necessarily intended to be super funny, but it was one of those things. As I am loving the growing bromance between Sam and Bucky.
Yes.
Can you move the seat forward? No.
Well, and that's one of those things. It's like it fits so well because Bucky is Cap's best friend from when, you know, they were growing up in Brooklyn.
Yep.
And Sam
is the new best friend.
Now. Yes. I mean, they're both still his best friend, but you know what I mean.
Yeah. But Sam knows.
I like the Spider-Man. Post-credits scene where he was talking about the fight, and he was like, his friend was huge.
He's like, he was from Brooklyn.
I was a guy called Steve from Brooklyn, who had a huge friend.
That and the bit where he's like, can you move your seat forward? No. It's like, and then right after that, when Steve and Sharon, you know, finally kiss, and then you pan back and Sam and Bucky are just nodding and smiling, like,
and they're just like,
nice,
yeah,
dude.
Our buddy. Especially like, cause Bucky, the first time we ever, or one of the first times we see Steve and Bucky is Bucky's trying to get Steve a date to the thing. And he's trying to get him.
70 plus years later, it's like,
yeah,
good for
you,
Bucky, dude.
I feel like there's sort of I feel like Bucky probably like felt really happy at that moment. It's like, after all these years, finally.
Yeah. we'll somewhat ignore the fact that, you know, Steve was locking lips with his former girlfriend's great niece.
Yeah. Well, this is sort of an unusual situation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, and I will say, Holly, you know, we didn't discuss this on the air for fear of possible spoilers, but Holly called it, because when there was a commercial for Civil War last week or the week before that, so it was the week of the movie being released, it was on during Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and it's a quick shot, but it's Steve carrying a casket. I'm like, oh, there's a funeral in the movie, and Holly's like, I bet it's Peggy, and she called it. So,
well, yeah, because like that was one of the first sad things I wanted to get to, and I guess now is a good time as any.
Yeah,
it's like when he got that text and it said, you know, she's gone, and I'm like, oh no, they didn't just kill off Peggy, and they did. Which I think made the news that Peggy, that Agent Carter was canceled, even more heartbreaking because we just had her funeral in the movie, and I'm like,
know.
This really just
she
cements
really is
the
gone.
Dust
like,
what gets me the most. I think about the show being canceled is like she just died in the movie.
Yes, and then they put a nod to that in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
like, potential spoilers.
Knife, guys.
Yeah. So it wouldn't surprise me though that Phil would be reading a newspaper headline that has anything to do related to, you know, the history of S.H.I.E.L.D. and or Captain America.
I saw a clip of the, like, someone gifted the shot of the article, and you can kind of read it as like talking about her like childhood and her work with the SSR.
Oh yeah. They know people are going to pause that stuff and read it and see what it actually says, so.
Oh, yeah. So
that's a Disney thing.
It was, like, a legit article.
Yeah. That doesn't surprise me any, actually. Mm-hmm. That's totally a Disney thing.
Which I'm glad they did that. Still doesn't excuse the fact they canceled her show.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but, you know.
Fingers crossed that Netflix does pick it up.
Yeah, really.
Yeah.
So, but I will say, you know, it was sad to have Peggy die, but at the same time, you know, it's like last time we saw her, she was really, really old and, you know, gone as far as her mind and all that, unfortunately. So it wasn't that shocking. So,
but it's still sad.
Yeah. But, and, you know, I mean this in the nicest way possible, but thank goodness she was the only hero death in the movie. Because I was expecting someone to die. I was really expecting, you know, one of the Avengers, you know, one of our heroes to die. And the fact that they all walked away alive.
Where Tony was, like, really badly injured after that fight in Siberia.
Yeah.
And died. It was like...
Yeah, I honestly, up until the point where they announced that Robert Downey Jr. is going to be in the new Spider-Man movie, I was sure that they were going to kill off Tony Stark. Absolutely sure they were going to kill him off, because Robert, you know, as much as Robert Downey Jr., I know, loves playing this role, he's getting up there in years, it's getting difficult for him to do the role. It's like, they can kill him off, and give him an out. Like,
He has done it for so long, and it's like, you know, you can't do it forever. At some point, you gotta
be done. even in Age of Ultron, when towards the end, when he and Steve are talking, you know, and he's talking about, you know, the team that Steve's gonna start training, and Tony's like, I'm out. You know, it was like, okay, well, there you go. You give him an out, and, you know, that's it. But as soon as they said Robert Downey Jr. is gonna be in this Spider-Man, I'm like, well, I guess he's not dying then.
Yeah. Well,
a little bit later, he said, "Oh yeah, I'm up for Iron Man 4." It's like,
It's like, make up your mind, dude.
Well, I was really worried too, because I thought, okay, Peggy, we're safe. But then that scene with Rhodey.
Yeah, I didn't think Rhodey was going to die, because I thought that was too heavy-handed. I thought they made it too obvious.
Yeah, so I was like, well, especially since it was in the trailer, and it's like, well, you're not going to reveal that he dies in the trailer.
Right.
I mean, come on.
I did not see him getting paralyzed, though. It's,
No.
They had this, after that, they had the scene where he was going in, like, the MRA machine, and Tony was talking about what injuries he had, and I'm like, oh, I said a few bad words in the theater under my breath. I'm like, oh, that's not good. Thankfully, in that universe, his best friend is is an engineering genius and can create mechanical stuff to help him potentially walk again, so.
Can we talk about the cutscene with them kind of doing his therapy and...
Yeah, we get the Stan Lee cameo. Don't bring it back up, because it's like Rhodey's, like, struggling doing physical therapy, and he falls on the ground, and... You know, Tony's like, you know, trying to help him. And he's like, no, let me do it. And Rhodey's giving this talk about, you know, I've done all these combat missions. And I always knew one of them could be my last. You know, the fact that I got this far unscathed is pretty darn good. Then you get Stan Lee. Like...
And there's Stan Lee is the FedEx guy. Yeah. Tony Stank.
Are you Tony Stank?
Tony Stank.
Which we've decided. Which our headcanon, we've decided that Steve, you know, did the thing with the cell phone. He probably had help because, you know, it's technology. And wrote the letter and packaged it up and gave it to, like, Clint and said, here, will you send this? And Clint managed to either wrote it on the label or at the FedEx office, had them write Stank on the label instead.
Yeah, Clint did it.
Yeah, Clint did it. Maybe with Scott's help.
Possibly.
But you're not
going to
live it down.
Exactly.
That was the best.
That was so funny.
And it came at just the right moment, because at the end, after the fight with Tony and Bucky and Cap, and that one was just like, oh, punch your heart out.
Ugh.
Yeah. And just, you know, that whole big thing with Zemo saying, like, you know, I want the Avengers to destroy themselves from the inside, and you're just, you know, everything, just you're emotionally stomped to pieces. And then here's Stan Lee, coming in with a package.
for no, Mr.
To bring,
Stank.
To bring the levity back up.
Mr. Stank.
Mr. Stank. Yeah. I know some of you guys said you didn't quite put two and two together, but I did. As soon as we had that opening with the flashback, you know, December 16th, 1991, you know, and we see the, you know, just the car driving down the road and, you know, the Winter Soldier on and causes it to crash and like, I wonder if that's Tony's parents.
See, I didn't even.
And then we saw it again. And then the third time we see the whole thing and it's like, yeah, that's Tony's parents.
I didn't even think about it until, you know, they were in Siberia and the guy brought up the video and everything and he's all like, and I'm like, oh no, oh no, oh no, oh no, oh no, oh no. And then it's like, oh.
Yeah.
Although I have one little nitpick about that scene. Yeah. Okay, so yes, it's
I have a couple
scene.
Actually.
Okay, well I'll do mine and then we'll get there. And I even thought about this in the theater because Tony sees the video and he's like, I know that road, I know that car, and you know he sees Bucky go up and the car crash, pull his dad out of the car, kill his dad, go around, kill his mom and everything. And I think it's interesting that Tony says, "You killed my mom," and not his dad. But anyway, we'll get there. Well, and then he turns to
his dad. Remember,
yeah.
Tony and his dad never had the best relationship.
That is true.
That
yes. Yeah, but I like that. I like that touch. I like that little touch there. But then he turns to Steve and he says, "Did you know?" And Steve nods like, "Yeah, I knew." And I'm like, and he's like, "You never told me." And I'm like, when would he have had time to tell you?
Mm-hmm.
Because the only time Steve could have known. Okay, so after, okay, so you had this the bombing at the Sokovia meeting. Then Steve tries to get Bucky out. They get arrested and taken to the place. And Tony's still trying to, you know, come sign the thing and all that stuff. And then they escape. And then Steve and Sam find Bucky, and Bucky tells them about, you know, December 1991.
And the other Winter Soldiers.
And the other Winter Soldiers and everything.
Yeah.
So I think that's when Bucky told Steve, but Steve did not have a chance to tell Tony because by then they were already at each other's throats.
Mm-hmm.
There was no chance for him to tell him.
And exactly how would you go about, hey, my best bud killed your parents,
Sorry.
No.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Have to fix this.
Right.
We don't.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand they're going for the emotional thing, but my first thought was when Steve nodded and Tony started wailing on him, I'm like, but there was no chance.
But
even
in that same scene, though, that Steve tells Tony, I didn't know it was Bucky. Mm-hmm. He just knew one of those Winter Soldiers killed his parents, but he didn't know which one.
Yeah.
Because who knows? Because I think he was maybe giving Bucky the benefit of the doubt, thinking, well, Bucky got framed for
the bombing.
Maybe he got. Maybe this is another framing for him killing Tony's parents.
Yeah.
Let me give him the benefit of the doubt instead of saying, "Hey, here it is."
Yeah.
Let's find this all out.
Yeah.
You know what's going on.
Yeah.
And I just am like that. That was my one thing.
Yeah. But Tony's not thinking rationally at that point.
No,
so we had been doing so good up to that point, actually, because Steve had tried to explain to Tony that Bucky had been framed for the bombing and killing, the King of Wakanda and all that. And Tony didn't believe him. And then Tony found saw the evidence, you know, that proved that Bucky was innocent for the bombing. So he goes to Siberia and they actually decide to work together. But then Zemo has to pull this crap. And it's like, you know, that those nice two steps forward that we were getting, it would just take like 57,000 steps back. But I mean, that it plays into Tony's personality though.
Yeah.
Is he's just very, he's hot-headed, always has been, always will be. You know, something sets him off, and you can't talk him down off that ledge. Especially now, after everything that's happened, you know, he had that the PTSD that we saw him dealing with in Iron Man 3 after the Battle of New York.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that eventually goes into him creating Ultron. But then that backfires on him, so there's even more guilt. And then, when he's at the MIT thing, and the lady, you know, hands him the picture of her son who died at Sokovia, and she blames him, which that's a play on something from the comics where that confrontation does happen, but Tony's actually at the kid's funeral. Mm-hmm. So Tony carries a lot of guilt for innocent lives lost. Mm-hmm. And so, this is just like the straw that broke the camel's back that,
pretty much.
He didn't have the best relationship with his father, but from what we know, Tony loved his mother very much and they had a very close relationship. So the fact that his mom is another innocent person that died because of being a Stark, I guess, in this case, because he probably blames his dad somewhat. And that's one of my issues with the Starks getting killed, is Bucky did that because he was trying to steal the super soldier serum-esque type stuff that they had in their car. Why were they transporting that in the first place? Why did they have that? Why did they carry that?
That's another line that was like considered that the post that I saw about the missing lives was why did your dad even have that?
Exactly. And like, we got a little bit of explanation with the MIT thing, with the virtual reality thing, which Chauncey was like, this is virtual reality. So as soon as that scene started, he's like, it's virtual reality. I'm like,
they were able to make Robert Downey Jr. look that.
The fact that it's in a virtual reality environment makes it easier to be like, well, it's not, you can tell it's a CG Robert Downey Jr., but it's in virtual reality anyway, so it works.
So that's very nice.
Yeah, and it's like, he's chatting with his parents. It's Christmas time. They're like, we've got to leave. Have a good Christmas break. We'll see you later, son. And he's like, we have to go do the thing.
Talking to him.
Yeah.
That this is the last time you'll ever see us. I'm like, oh, this isn't actually. This is how he remembers it, or how he wishes it would.
But he makes that. They say something about how they've got to go to wherever, and he's like via the Pentagon, which I think probably explains somewhat why they were transporting the serum, is they were probably doing something for the government.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's like
security, though.
Yeah.
Unless Hydra got to them too, and then Winter Soldier just planted.
It's just, the whole thing surrounding the death of the Starks, I think, still has a lot of unanswered questions that I hope get answered in future films.
They could have done it at Agent Carter.
They could have.
Maybe they can. The backstory with Howard and Pym, because Tony didn't even know about that when
Ant-Man
brought that up.
Yeah, he's like, Hank Pym says never trust a Stark. He's like, who are you? Mm-hmm. Which I knew that's why Scott was going to be on Team Cap. Because he's friends with Hank Pym, and Hank Pym won't trust Tony Stark if his life depended upon it. So, because so many people are like, why is Ant-Man on Team Cap? I'm like, did you not see Ant-Man?
Yeah. Did you not see how much Hank Pym hates
Howard Stark?
You didn't see him punch?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Gotta see the rest of the movies! They make it make sense. So
yes, it's all one big thing, guys.
It is. Yes. All connected.
We said it before. We'll say it again. It's all connected.
Yeah. So
there's a reason that's still their mantra.
Yeah, exactly.
Because it's true.
Yeah, exactly. So, but yeah, just that knockdown, drag out fight in Siberia between Tony, Bucky, and Steve is just, it's brutal. It's brutal,
Even was in for a world of hurt when Cap's shield came down. I'm like,
I was still a little scared for Tony, even though I knew that he's going to be in Spider-Man and he probably isn't going to die. For a minute there, I'm like, is he going to take his head off or something?
Yeah, I was like, I kept like you said, you were afraid Tony wasn't going to make it out. I actually thought Cap was going to die in this one because
he does in the comics.
Yeah, I was gonna say in the comics, Captain America does die.
Yeah.
But I mean, I know they were doing this different, but it's like, would they still keep that in there? But and they didn't, which I was glad. But I mean, in some ways, this is almost worse because there's this rift between everybody. Like at the end, when Tony yells out, you know, Cap is he's got Bucky, and they're like kind of hobbling out of there, and Tony yells, "You don't deserve that shield. You're my dad." You know, that my dad designed, you know, my dad made that, that's not yours. And Steve just drops it. And he's just like, and Tony's back there railing and yelling. And Steve just calmly just leaves it behind. And I'm like, oh, that's somehow worse than if you had died or whatever. Because it's just, you know, they're all, these guys, they were all friends. And now they're not. All because of one scummy little weaselly, guy who wanted to tear him apart for no reason.
Exactly. So, I mean, they may have been able to work through the Sokovia Accords eventually.
Yeah.
Without Zemo's interference, but that just made everything times worse.
I'm sure at some point they would have found out about, you know, they would have figured out about, you know, the Starks and how they died, but that was not the best way for Tony to find out.
I'm glad we finally got to see Tony's mom, though. The fabled Maria Stark.
No kidding.
Well, I think I had read an article somewhere. Robert Downey Jr. was saying, hey, we need to do this. We need to show Mama Stark. The mother-son relationship. Glad they listened.
Chauncey's one question with, you know, Bucky killing the Starks is, Chauncey's interpreting the fact that Bucky took out Howard with his metal arm, but killed Tony's mom with his human arm means something. I don't know what, but
the way he killed Howard was a lot more brutal than the way he killed Maria.
Yeah.
Cause you know, he smashed Howard's face in, and Maria, he just strangled her.
Yeah.
Or maybe that's just because, I don't know. Maybe that's just because Howard was already bloodied from the car crash or something. I don't know.
I think Howard was worse off because of the crash to begin with. It looked like, even though he was able to get out of the car, his injuries may have been more severe, you know, so Bucky just did it, you know, knowing that it would be quick and to the point. But I don't know. So again, it's one of those floating question marks around the death of Tony's parents. It's like, will we get more answers? Maybe, eventually. We'll probably get answers in 5 movies from now, probably.
We got answers and just more questions. Exactly. So, you know, this is normal.
Yeah. So, but ooh, man. I'm all like, can we all just get along?
Seriously.
Like, y'all are going to have to put on your big boy pants when a certain big purple guy comes down from the heavens and wants to destroy y'all.
Yeah, you need
to get your crap together. You need to get together now.
So,
but you know, one thing,
session.
Yeah.
Yeah. So everyone sit down.
Banner. Banner's like, I'm not that kind of doctor.
Yeah, I could just see Natasha sitting everybody down in a room and saying, okay, we're going to talk this out. No suits, no beating each other up, no superpowers, just going to talk. And I love that she, at the end of the airport fight, like, she's the one that lets Cap and Bucky get out of there and go to Siberia. And, you know, even though she's Team Iron Man for most of the movie, She kind of gets that there's more to this than just
the more than meets the eye.
Yeah. So that, you know, she's not fully on board with all of this.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I like that.
Yeah. It doesn't surprise me any with Natasha. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's like she knows. She's not dumb, you know, and she's good at not letting her emotions get the best of her.
Yeah. So. And she knows that there's probably invisible strings that are being pulled that yeah. need to get cut.
Very much so.
Well, I mean, and she has experience with that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Sometimes she's been the pulley, sometimes she's been the puller, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She knows there's one, you know, there's the two sides and then there's the truth in the middle. Mm-hmm. And she's willing to, you know, let both sides, you know, try to keep both sides from killing each other till the truth can come forward. Mm-hmm. So, which is exactly what she did. She bought them some time and it worked for a little bit. Like we said, you know, Tony goes to Siberia, you know, hands up, like I'm here to help. Yeah. No fighting. And it ends up backfiring. And
then it all just hits the fan.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Ish hits the fan, so. Yeah.
All that I said before, I take that back.
Yeah. Pretty much.
So. Oh, my. Oh. Everybody needs a bunch of Snickers.
Yeah, really?
Yes. Snicker party.
Yeah.
Everybody.
Really?
Avengers Tower.
Yeah. Oh. Ugh. Anyway.
Who would deliver those Snickers? Coulson or Fury?
Yeah, we need Fury to show up and tell everybody to knock their crap out.
Yeah, I want to know. I know Fury's supposed to be on the down low, but they know he's alive. It's like, what is Fury doing that he didn't show? Because, you know, if Nick Fury had been in this, he would have shown up like 5 minutes into their arguing and say, sit down! We're gonna work this out. It'd be like Natasha, but with way more yelling.
Yeah, and probably more profanity.
Yes. Yeah, take Samuel Jackson in Snakes on a Plane and Pulp Fiction, but with an eye patch.
Yes.
And
probably a couple of backhands upside the head.
Probably.
All of the above, yes.
Yeah, exactly. So. So. And somewhere Maria Hill is at Stark headquarters going, really?
Like, I did not sign up for this. Oh, yeah, wait, yes, I did.
Yeah, she did, actually. So. Yeah, I wondered if we'd see Fury in this movie, but, yeah, I'm not surprised that we didn't.
I think it would have ended too quickly if he'd been there.
We wouldn't have much of a movie.
Tell them all to knock it off. Yeah.
Like Ant-Man and Spider-Man would have showed up and he'd be like, who the F are you? What are you doing here?
Yeah. Well, I think Nick Fury would have put a stop to the Sokovia Accords. You would have just said, we ain't doing this.
Just like in the Avengers, like the council's made a decision. I understand the council's made a decision, but seeing that's a stupid decision, I'm elected to ignore it.
Exactly. He would have just recycled that line from Avengers, and it would have worked.
Exactly. Insert Nick Fury line here. It's applicable to all situations. No, I wonder if maybe we won't. You know, if Fury may not come back. You know, down the road. So for something else, maybe in maybe he'll be in Thor, next Thor movie. So I'm still holding on, you know, as adamant as I was up to a certain point that Tony was going to die in this movie, I'm still holding on to my explanation that the reason we don't see Thor or the Hulk in this movie is because when Thor Ragnarok comes out, it's going to be like Iron Man 2 and Thor, where they're happening at the same time.
Well, they even mentioned, like, well, where's Thor? Where's Banner? And isn't Banner's, or, you know, Hulk supposed to be in Thor Ragnarok?
Yes.
Or am I?
Okay. Yeah, no, he is. And that's why. Because I thought that was true, but I'm staunchly holding on to that explanation. It's going to be Fury's big week all over again.
Well, I mean, and they even brought it up. Ross brought it up, like, well, where's Thor? Where's Hulk? And I'm like, well, Thor's on another planet, so.
And I think Hulk is there with him.
Yeah, so.
What's your point?
Guy gets out of line. Yeah.
Yes. Yep.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, I think Ross needs to get his face slapped nine ways to Sunday.
Well, he can get in line right with Glenn Talbot from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, that could be too. Yeah, because after that whole thing where he shows up in S.H.I.E.L.D. and he's like, Sokovia Accords, Sokovia Accords, and Coulson just says, stick it.
Yeah. Yeah. And that kind of puts a check mark in Steve Rogers' favor, even with Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. when the stuff's going down, which we'll talk about that, you know, in a couple of weeks.
But
when we discuss it, yeah. Like, you know, Talbot's all like, this is what the Sokovia Accords are for. And I'm like, Talbot, a pile of papers is not going to stop this that's going on right now. I'm sorry.
And in that moment,
Glenn, get your head out of your butt.
In that moment, I was Team Phil.
Yeah. Yeah, Phil is Team Cap. Even though Phil is a company man, Clark Gregg has said that Phil would probably be Team Cap. So.
Well, to Talbot being Sokovia, of course, Sokovia Accords was like, no, that's not. We're secret.
Yes.
And if we sign these, we won't be secret. And yes. We need to be secret.
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 Shh. What part of that time?
Nobody knows.
So, yeah, I don't. I told Chauncey after because the people that went in Team Cap into the movie came out Team Cap. Mm-hmm. You know, I know some people that went in were Team Stark, kind of switched sides a little. I told Chauncey after the fact. I'm like, you know what? I'm not Team Stark. I'm not Team Cap. I'm Team Vintage Volkswagen Beetle.
Yep. I'll take it.
I am Team Aunt May. How's that? All the people, even Andre talked about that in his, like, both his non-spoilery and spoilery Civil War review, and people are like, why is Aunt May so young? I'm like, well, because Peter's like 16, so he's not going to have a 70-year-old aunt.
Yes,
so.
This is true. Unless she's like great Aunt May.
Yeah, really. Yeah.
So. Brilliant casting for Aunt May, if I do say so.
Yeah. It's like, hello, Marissa Tomei, have not seen you in a while. What you been up to?
That's what she and Tony were talking about. Because wasn't she and weren't those two in like a movie some time ago?
Her and Robert Downey Jr. Probably.
Yeah. I saw like some meme about that. I don't know.
Yeah.
I didn't remember. It was before I saw the movie, so I was trying to avoid spoilers. Yeah. And I was like, nope. So I didn't really look at it very closely.
Yeah. But, ugh. Good movie. Good movie. So good.
Very good movie.
I mean,
just in the field, then it was probably a whole lot better than what we were kind of
expecting. Well, I mean, going into it, you know, I knew enough from the comics to kind of expect, depending on how close they decided to keep to the source material. And, you know, I was expecting some feels. I was also expecting there to be some laughter. I knew there was going to be a Stanley cameo, and it was probably going to be funny, because his usually are.
Yep.
You know, I was excited to see the, you know, new Spider-Man. You know, just, we didn't get to see a lot of him in the trailer. I know that he's in a couple of the other, like, clip trailer things that were like, released before it came out. But I didn't watch those. I'm like, I don't want to see anymore. So it was just the one trailer that I really saw him in. But then seeing him at the red carpet, and seeing the actor talk, and I'm like, oh, he's kind of cute. I like him. You should stick around. You think you got a bright future, kid. You know, and then Black Panther, too. We don't see a lot of him in the trailer, but it's just a nice little tease. But then both of them, you know, bringing, it's like, when you think about, you know, when we started with Iron Man, Thor, the Hulk, and Captain America, with their standalone films. And then, you know, we get the first Avengers movie, and that brings in Black Widow, although Black Widow was in Iron Man 2, but, you know, more Black Widow, and we get a little bit of Hawkeye in Thor, but, you know, they get a bigger role, so, you know, it's like, you know, we have this nice little group, but now we have Ant-Man, and eventually we're going to have the Wasp, and now we've got Spider-Man, and now we've got Black Panther, and we've got the Guardians of the Galaxy, which are still off in their own movie, but they're going to cross, at least some of them are going to cross paths. At the very least, we're going to get Peter Quill brought in. The Russo brothers have already said they're very excited about bringing Star-Lord in with the rest of, you know, with the Avengers. Mm-hmm. So we're going to, at the very least, get one of the Guardians of the Galaxy. We still have Captain Marvel, I think, yes. At some point. You know, yep. How Doctor Strange is going to fit into this, we don't know yet. So we've still got more players that are going to be brought in. So it's like, it's the, you know, the RSVP list is just getting bigger and bigger and bigger as we lead and get closer to Infinity War. It's like, how are they going to make this work with this many people?
Well, and I wondered going into this movie, like, same thing. How are they going to make this work? And they did it. And yes. It's like, everybody got a good enough time. And, I mean, okay, yeah, I haven't seen Batman v Superman, nor do I really want to. But I've seen a lot of people be like, yeah, that's how that, this is how they should have done that movie. Because it kind of felt... People say it felt too stuffed, and the characters didn't get enough time individually to do what they needed to do, mm-hmm. and all that other stuff. So I'm like, I'm not worried. I'm just curious how it's gonna work, and you know, going by what we got with Civil War, with all the side characters felt like they got enough time, and you know, they all had memorable moments and things. I'm like, oh yeah, this is gonna work. This mm-hmm. is gonna work.
Exactly.
It's going to be awesome. Exactly.
And like I said, considering the Russo brothers that directed this with this crap ton number of people in it are also doing Infinity War, I think it's in good hands.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. So.
So yeah, they know they know how to do ensemble stuff. In fact, they did a couple episodes with Screen Junkies about like with Honest Trailers and mm-hmm. and stuff, and they were kind of talking about like Winter Soldier and Civil War and some other stuff, and they're like, yeah, we like doing ensemble casts and having all these people there, and it's something that they've kind of, you know, put their stamp on, that this is what they do. And I'm like, cool. Mm-hmm. If you guys can do it this well, keep doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I will continue to pay for movie tickets.
Yeah. Exactly. So.
Although I have to make this one comment, not about the movie itself, but mm-hmm. when we went to see it, and we were like, you know, sitting there watching the trailers, we didn't get a lot of I think we got X-Men trailers. Or we didn't get a lot of we got Doctor Strange. We got Doctor Strange and X-Men.
I didn't get Doctor Strange.
I was noticing that there were so many WB movies, like Warner Brothers movie trailers, that weren't necessarily. We didn't get Suicide Squad, but there were a lot of Warner Brothers trailers attached to Civil War, and I'm just like, are you guys saying something? Your comic book movies stink, so you have to, but you know, people show up for Marvel movies, so you have to attach your trailers to them.
Yeah.
I was like, that was so funny. There weren't even any Disney trailers at the showing we went to, so I was just like,
yeah.
That's funny.
I don't know... I don't remember everything we got. We didn't get Doctor Strange. We got Rogue One, though.
We didn't even get Rogue One.
So
we saw it in the theater lobby, but we didn't. Cause we showed up early for dinner, but we didn't.
Yeah, and we got the Independence Day Resurgence. Mm-hmm. So those are the two I remember. But a lot of times I go to a movie and the trailers, and I'm all like, I didn't even know that was being made.
Yeah, I don't even remember. The only trailer I remember with any sort of clarity was the comedy with The Rock and Kevin Hart, and I'm just like, yeah, this looks stupid. Yeah. So I'm probably not going to go see it. But I just, I remember seeing the WB logo on there, and I'm like, desperate much, guys? Not that this has to be a competition, but it kind of feels like they're making it one.
Try all you might, but, I haven't checked it recently, but I know, I think it was like the Saturday or maybe Sunday, last Sunday after Civil War came out, and I think it was Rotten Tomatoes, Civil War was like 93% fresh or something like that. Batman versus Superman is like 46%.
Yeah, it's not.
It's bad.
We knew going in, or you know, when they announced Batman v Superman, Dawn of Justice, blah blah blah. We knew this was going. It looked like a desperate attempt to catch up to Marvel, and they kind of proved it. Mm-hmm. I guess. Like I said, I haven't seen the movie. I don't really want to after everything I've heard, and it's not just either. It's not just people on the internet, random strangers. It's people I know that have seen it, and they're like, yeah, it's not very good. So I'm like, okay, good to know. I will stay away.
Yep. So, and it's made over $900 million worldwide. So.
Civil War. Okay.
So it's quickly making its way to the $1 billion mark, so.
Yep. They made back their money.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. They made back the production cost just in the domestic receipts. So, and I don't know if it's released everywhere worldwide yet. I don't know if like places like China and all that have gotten it yet, so.
Yeah,
because they tend to be a few weeks behind. I know that was the way it was with Star Wars, with Episode 7. Yeah,
they didn't get it till like January or February, and they were all saying that, because they were comparing, once it gets into China, it's really going to make a lot of money.
Yeah.
It was making so much domestically and even in other places that internationally that weren't China.
Yeah.
But, yep.
Yeah, John C. and I are going to go see it again. Probably. Yeah. Maybe in 3D. No. Now that I've seen it, I know when I can get up to go to the bathroom if I need to.
Yes.
That's what it is with these movies. I'm like, I got to watch what I consume beforehand because I don't want to get up.
I know. I was like, because we went like right after Jared got off work and we were going, or no, wait, I can't remember. But anyway, we'd made plans to have dinner there, and we're like, okay, do you want to refill your drink before you go in? And like, no. Because then I'd have to get up and I didn't want to. Although we went and saw, because we had some gift cards, some Megaplex gift cards from like our wedding and Christmas, and Jared got one for his birthday. So we actually splurged and we sat in the VIP theater that like has the recliners and the people will like deliver your food to you and everything. And it was way nice. So it was like, So it was kind of cool. It was like, yeah, for Civil War, we'll do this. We won't do it all the time, but.
I tried to go to the bathroom during the credits, hoping I wouldn't miss the scene, but I did.
No.
Aww.
The first credit, I missed the mid-credit scene, but my dad described what happened to me when I got back.
That's good.
And then I saw the one at the very end, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I liked the Wakanda one better than I liked the Spider-Man one, because I kind of figured the Spider-Man one was coming at some point. And I love how at the end it's like, Spider-Man will return, and we're like, yay!
Like, no surprise!
No surprise, but then they have, like, Wakanda, and you see the whole, like all their state-of-the-art stuff. Like, I was watching it, and I don't know how many of you played Fallout 4, but it reminded me of the Institute, which is like this underground, super high-tech thing, which is a stark contrast to like the wasteland and desolation outside. Mm-hmm. And so like Wakanda kind of reminded me of this, of of the really super secretive high tech institute. I'm like, this is cool, but their motivations are not, you know, utter domination or whatever it is.
Yeah,
they just want to. They just have a lot of resources at their disposal, and they want to keep them. Mm-hmm. So, like I said, I'm excited for a Black Panther movie.
Me too. And Spider-Man.
The pullback shot from them looking out the window, and you see that great big panther.
In the jungle with the waterfalls and everything, I'm like, ooh,
I know.
I want
pretty. Can we go on vacation?
Like you talk about, like I don't know what everybody was. I knew nothing about Wakanda going into this, so I'm like, okay, it's a country in Africa. They have a king. There's like this tribal warrior culture type of thing. So I don't know really like what I expected, but it wasn't that. And I was like, wow, this is really cool.
Mm. Yeah, I knew a little bit of that about Wakanda going into it, because I haven't actually read the comics, but I've seen people, like, talking about that sort of stuff, and I've read about that sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it made me eager for the next... So because after Cap got all the of his team of Avengers out of the prison, I was like, okay, well, where are you gonna go now? Because you know Avengers Tower is lost to you, but then they pull back like, oh, we're going to Wakanda, and I'm like, I'm cool with this. And King T'Challa is like, yep, you can, you know, whatever you need to do, and what, you know, our facilities are at your disposal. So I was like, sweet. And I love the part where they go, you know, where Cap goes, you know, they're going to come after you. And T'Challa's all, let them try.
Like, Wakanda seems like a beautiful place, but I don't know if I want to mess with any of the people. Because he's like, let them try. And then the other lady's like, move or be moved. I'm like, okay.
Yeah, you don't mess around with those guys.
Yeah. That's fine with me. It's all good. Anything else? Other than, can we get up on our soapbox here just for a second and say, people, do not get up until the credits are over. What are you doing?
I'm like, how many Marvel movies is this, people?
Because I missed
13 Marvel movies. Like, don't get up.
I passed my dad's friend leaving. It was like, and then I get back to my seat, and my dad's like, there's another scene, right? I was like, yeah.
Yeah.
And before the first post-credit scene, people were leaving, and I was like, I almost yelled out in the theater, like, don't leave, there's another one. And I was like, you know what, if they're going to leave, that's their problem.
Like, don't leave, there's more.
Like, what are you doing?
Yeah. Every single solitary movie, people start to get up as soon as it's like the end. I'm like, where are you going? Oh well. I don't know. Anyway.
You know, if they don't get it by now, they're never going to get it. So.
Well, and the thing, I mean, like, I could kind of understand, like, if you go on, like, maybe a Saturday afternoon or something, you know, maybe.
Or if you
like,
have little kids.
You've got little kids, you know, they're not going to want to wait. But I went on a Thursday night, and, you know, it's the diehards that go on, like, opening night, first showing. You're like, I don't care if it's a work night or a school night. I'm seeing this movie as soon as possible. You know, the film is barely dry. I need to see this right now. And people... And our audience was really good during the movie. Like, people were reacting. It's been a while since I've been in a movie where people are, like, you know, gasping at the right places and clapping and cheering and laughing. But then as soon as the credits start, they get up. And I'm like, you're the diehards. Why are you going? Why are you leaving?
Yeah.
So, they're a loss. Whatever.
Like, pretty much, yeah.
Gotta leave. a Marvel movie before the end of the
Well, credits. These days, you don't leave any movie before the credits are over.
Well, you know, within the last...
I definitely know Marvel, but
yeah.
With other movies, I usually wait to see, like, are people talking about, is there a mid-credits or post-credits scene?
Yeah.
If I've been told that there isn't, I generally won't wait.
Unless it's a Marvel movie, because with Age Ultron, we were told there wasn't one, and I still waited.
As anything, you know there's going to be post-credit scenes at a Marvel movie.
Yeah.
But with, like, other studios, it's like, has someone told me that there's going to be a post-credit scene? If no, I'm gone. If yes, then I stay.
I think a lot more, I think they're doing more and more, so even then I'm like, I'll stay until, you know, the theater ads start coming up, because I know then, yep, we're done. Yeah. I know for sure that it's over.
Well, when the lights come on, they start sweeping the floor, you know, you can...
Like, yeah, that's pretty safe to
you
say.
You can get up and walk away.
You can go.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm probably going to get on that soapbox for every Marvel movie till end of time.
Because
I'm on a limb.
Not everybody gets it.
Yeah. Well, like I said, even with Age Ultron, when they said that there would be a mid-credit one, but not a post-credit, we still stayed just in case. And then when there wasn't one and the lights came up, the few people that stayed with us, we all looked at each other like, well, I guess they weren't lying.
Guess they were telling us the truth. Yep. Okay.
Like, okay, we can go now.
We know for sure. We know that they weren't trolling us.
Yeah, exactly.
So. Oh, well.
Anyway.
Good movie, everyone.
Yep.
We liked it.
Good job, Marvel. No.
Well, we will continue to grace you with our money.
Yeah, exactly. I'll paraphrase, but as Lou Mangiello posted on his Facebook last week, dear Kevin Feige, thank you. Please keep up the good work.
Yeah, I saw that on Lou's Facebook.
Yeah. He's like, thank you.
I was like, that's a good sign.
Exactly. 900 million dollars. Gotta be doing something right.
Yeah, no kidding. Mm-hmm. All right, ladies. Yeah. Well, we all love Civil War. We want to hear if you loved it or what else you have to say about it. So if you have anything you want to talk to us about Civil War or any of our other things that we talk about on this podcast, please feel free to contact us via our website, thefiveishfangirlspodcast.blogspot.com. You'll find links there to all of our social media, Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, Pinterest, YouTube, and iTunes were there as well. And you can also email us. Our email address is fiveishfangirls@gmail.com. And if you send us feedback, we will read it out on the podcast and mm-hmm. start the discussion there. And then also, if you are so inclined, please support us on Patreon. And thank you always, as always, to those who are currently supporting us. We can't do this without you, and we're glad that you feel like our fangirly ramblings are worth a little bit of extra cash that you send our way, and it all goes back into the podcast. So again, we appreciate again. Mm-hmm. If you want to donate, the links are there on our website as well.
Mm-hmm.
So contact us. And also there's the Traveling the Vortex book club, Doctor Who book club. So if you are reading the book this month, go check that out as well. There's links to that on our website there.
Woohoo! Yep. And I guess that's all we got for now. So next couple weeks will be season recaps for Once Upon a Time and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So be prepared for rants.
Everything.
And feels and, yeah, definitely feels and definitely some rants for Once Upon a Time.
Oh boy! I think I'll just be permanently parked on my soapbox there. Probably. Although I will say this: it still is not as bad as the Neverland arc. Yeah. That's like so. You know, it has a long way to go for me to be mad. If anything ever goes below that, you know it's bad. But it hasn't. This one didn't hit that. Although I haven't seen the finale yet, which I will probably go do. If not tonight, then I'll do tomorrow.
And we will have our, we'll probably do that one next week, so save your comments for them.
Okay.
And then we'll do Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. after that, and then beyond that, we'll figure it out, because we've got to make some plans for some things, because we have another birthday coming up, actually.
Woohoo! Happy birthday to us.
For the show, so, and then conventions and all that fun stuff. So,
which Salt Lake Comic Con actually made their first batch of announcements this week. Which the biggest name is William Shatner, but we'll talk about that another time.
Yeah,
probably could have included that in our news list, but yeah. We forgot.
It's Shatner. He's everywhere. So,
yeah, I think it's something to do with Star Trek's 50th.
Yeah, probably.
Anyway,
we'll figure that out off the air.
We will. Okay. We best be getting off.
Yeah. Because
tis getting late for some of us.
Yes, not all. Yes. So with that, we shall sign off for this week.
This is Chrissy in Salt Lake City saying goodnight.
Mitch saying goodnight from Kitchener, Ontario.
And this is Rachel in Indianapolis, Indiana. Anyone got any orange slices?
Listening to the Five-ish Fangirls podcast. Any and all movies, books, games, and other forms of media mentioned are owned and operated by their respective copyright holders. No copyright infringement is intended or implied.